Hi, I'm Rob Cosman. Welcome to my shop. In this video, we're going to talk about box making, and in particular, the wood hinge dowel jig. The secret to success in doing these boxes is customizing your dowel so that when you make the hinge, it literally disappears as the lid closes. This is what we're going to focus on. I'm going to show you everything I know. Stay with us. I'm Rob Cosman, and welcome to my shop. We make it our job to help take your woodworking to the next level. If you're new and you haven't subscribed, please do so. Hit the notification bell so you'll receive alerts when we release a new video. And anytime we use a special tool, we'll always leave a description down below. All right, let's get to work. One of the nicest things about doing these boxes is when you can pull it off so that you can literally have that hinge disappear. Now you'll notice this is bird's eye in the back, bird's eye on the top, bird's eye in the front. So obviously my hinge has to be bird's eye. And if you do it just right, you can make it so that it doesn't get seen until you actually open the lid. By the way, this is a 7-piece hinge. We also play with that as well. So the problem with doing this with store-bought dowel, number one, rarely does it come perfectly sized. Number two, it often is not perfectly round. And number three, where are you going to buy bird's eye maple or figured maple dowel? So learning how to do this yourself so that you can perfectly match that. I mean, there's been times when I've gone in and actually taken, for instance, when I was preparing this piece of the back, I actually took a piece of wood right out of here and made the dowel out of that so that when it goes back together, it's almost invisible. In fact, you saw that one already, but no harm seeing it again. So this is the jig. This was the very first one I made. This would date back into 1987. It's not a pretty sight. And I played around with it until it worked. And then I left it just as it is. It's made out of lignin, which is a naturally oily wood, which also helps and wears much better. If you use regular hardwoods, you're gonna find that they're not gonna last very long and they'll have a tendency to burn too. Just problematic. So I suggest you get a naturally oily exotic wood to make this out of. And it'll take a few tries and we have to mess around with this a lot to finally get it to where it produces that dowel. And you want that dowel to be matched perfectly to your jig that you use for drilling the holes. So we're actually gonna get the micrometer of the digital calipers out. So when we are doing this, we get it to the point where it's right on the money. Now, it's a little bit of trial and error, I'll be the first to admit. And sometimes when I build these, because I've made off other sizes since then, but you're literally having to play around and just check it and test it and check it and test it until you finally get it just right. So get your notepad, you're going to want to take some notes on this one. All right, I'm going to show you how this works quickly and then we'll go through it in a little more detail. I start with a piece of square stock, this is a piece of cherry. Just a little bit over a quarter, so if you can see on there how much over, and then I cut a shorter piece using the block plane. I knock off the corner so it turns it in more of a hexagon, and then I just point it so that it's going to go into the jig a little better. Now it's really important that you enter that so that you're in line with the rest of the hole through the block. So I have it set up like this so I can see along the side of the bench. The height one's a little bit of a challenge, but you can do it. So start off slow and you'll just kind of feel your way to where you're lined up with the hole. You want to keep that sawdust out of there too, because if not, it gets into the hole and messes it up. And then I'm just going to chuck it up again. I'm going to pull it backwards, or spin it backwards as I pull it through. Now hopefully we end up with a piece of dowel that's nice and smooth, and that's pretty good. Now let's check it for size. We want it to be as close to 1/4 inch as possible. So that's just 1 thou over, checking a few places. That's right on. That's right on. So it's certainly within. Yeah, that one's a little bit stronger. That's within 1 thou. So that I would consider to be a good piece.
Okay.
So when we make this, as I mentioned, you need to have a wood that's going to stand up to the wear. So any of the hard exotics are going to work well because they actually self-lubricate. The opening has to be larger to accept the piece that's not a quarter of an inch yet. What I did is I drilled the hole all the way through first, and you've got to use a really good quality bit because you want that hole to be as close to being quarter inch as possible. And you want it to go, you want the hole to be drilled so it's parallel to the outside edge of the board. Because I did, I went in with a table saw and I opened up or exposed this backside and left this so that I had as much of that full circle as possible to help center that as it gets fed into the blade. Now the blade has to be positioned so that it's cutting on the top of the circle, and it also has to be positioned height-wise. You can see a shims that I've put in here so that it's producing a quarter inch piece of dowel, and you can tell by the fit on it when it's coming out the backside. Now, there's an upside and a downside to having a wide piece. The wider it is, the more it steers the piece as you go through so that you don't have to worry about entering on an angle. Once you get started, it kind of takes over and it'll pull it in. The downside to that is it creates a lot of friction. So if you're dealing with a narrow dowel like quarter of an inch, too much friction and you risk having that break on you. I'm able to do long pieces. Here's a piece of Chuck de Coke that's almost 4 feet long. We did lots of those and that turned out beautifully smooth and right on quarter of an inch. So it's possible. I actually think when we'll make this one, I'll make this a little out of a little bit wider piece just to try it and see if we can't make it even easier to have that engage and stay perfectly in line with the backside of the hole. And I found a piece of bloodwood. Might not be my first choice, but it was the right size. And I think we can make it work. Just so that you know, it is, this just happened to be how long it was. It's 6 3/4 by 2 inches by 7/8 of an inch thick. Now I'm gonna drill a hole down this way and I want it to be parallel to the face. So I just wanna make sure that the edge is nice and square. That actually looks pretty good. Okay, now I use this as a pattern and I've got to use this flaring tool in order to open it up. So what we want is when we feed this piece through that's been cut into a hexagon, we want it to fit into that circle. Now that hasn't been turned into a hexagon, but even a square. And then that'll guide it in. But obviously this is too big and you wouldn't be able to get to the blade. That's the reason why we have to knock the corners off. So I'm telling you that because I can't cut it too close to the edge because that would eliminate this larger diameter opening that we're going to get from the flaring tool. I don't want to be too close to the middle because it doesn't leave us enough bottom material in the bottom, and I don't want that to flex at all. I'm going to say we go right about here, which is just a little bit left of center. Now I'm going to use a 1/4 inch fish bit. That's a very clean, precise hole. And I'm going to use my drill press. I want to make sure that the drill press is set up so that it's drilling nice and square, and I'm going to clamp this in place so that nothing moves, because when we come in and expose the hole on the table saw, we want that to be even exposure from one side to the other. You'll see what I mean when we do it. Okay, I've got a piece of pine clamped on here. Check it with the square. Now we'll put that in place. And I made sure that this will go all the way down because I want to, after I drill it, I'm going to take this out without changing anything. I'll put that flaring tool in there so I can cut that opening as well. And this may seem like overkill, but I want this to turn out. I don't want anything to move. This has a tendency to really chatter, so I'll just go slow speed, slow feed. Want that about 3/8 of an inch? Okay, that's 3/8. Is just start making cuts. That's what I don't want. That should have been opened up all at the same time. So I'm going to, what am I going to do? I think what I'll do is I'll put a piece of masking tape right along here, and that'll kick that out just a little bit, and hopefully we can even that up. And I should have said the top, not the bottom. Another piece. Still not quite even. So when we put that blade on that surface, that blade back needs to be parallel to that opening. I had to open that up a whole lot more than I wanted to, so we're gonna have to build that up quite a bit. It's quite a few shims. Now, I think, based on the way we have this one, about an angle about like that, but where we want that cutting edge to be is right here, and in the middle. We want the cutting edge to pass over
at that spot right there. So we'd move it out to about there. But we also have to determine how much pad, how many shims we need to go underneath there. So I'm going to see if I can get a close guess. Okay, I'm going to put the drill that I used. Those flutes are really sharp. I'll stick it in the back like that. And that'll allow us to get some idea as to where we need to be. Now, Jake had a better idea, and that is that we can put the tape on the wood instead of putting it on, trying to figure out exactly where to put it on the back of the blade. So I'm just going to put a bunch of pieces on here, knowing that each one of these is 5 thou. Come on. Still raising up. Okay, I can't feel that making contact. So let's try that. I've got some 1 thou shim stock I can use to get really close. Now we got to guess at where that midpoint is. That's where the cone stops. And that's about midway right there. Now I'm going to use a C clamp that I can get a lot of pressure with. I'm going to run several pieces. Now, there are several ways you can do this. You can set it up on the table saw, you could do it on the band saw, or you can do it with a plane. So I've got it set so the point is straight up. Just count how many strokes you take on each pass or each corner. 6. And I can tell by the way the grain is tearing that I was going the wrong way. Not that it's that big of a deal. But on this one, I'll just, instead of flipping it in for hand, I'll just turn it over and this should work out better. And what I do is I have my fingers are running on both sides, keeping that plane from tipping. And this doesn't have to be extremely precise, you're just trying to get rid of excess material. And that's not terribly accurate as a hexagon, but corners are an octagon, but the corners are knocked off. Now the next thing we want to do is sharpen it like a pencil, and that'll allow the dowel to go down into that opening, and you'll have a much better chance of getting it to stay true. I'm going to cut this in half so we'll have a couple of pieces to work with. You can just a regular pencil sharpener. Hopefully that'll hold that on center. Or you can put it in your drill and then using a disc or a belt sander, you can simply spin it against it. I don't know if a block, standing block is gonna do very well. I was actually talking to a friend, Jack Lane, just a few days ago, and his first try, very first setup, and he got it right. Lucky. So put that in there. Now I can already tell that we're not, we need to come this way because I'm burning the piece of wood before it even makes it to the blade. So what we'll do, in fact, I don't know what I was looking at when I did that. That should have been sitting up here somewhere. So I'm going to move the cutter forward. Angle it a little bit more. Try it there. Nope, resistance still. And I'm just guessing at this as to where it should be. I'm gonna go over, that point is not very well centered. I'm gonna see if I can fix that on the disc sander. That's tight because I can see it's actually burning. All right, let's check that. Where's my calipers? It looks like that blood would actually stain the wood. Well, that's coming out 2.248. So if we raise this up just a little bit, in fact, that might be where we want to put a piece of 1/1 shim. Now I'm going to draw a line on here so I can put that blade back in the same spot. Okay, we'll try another piece. I'm just going to point it. Except for the bloodwood staining that piece of cherry, that's nice and smooth. Let's check it for size. Yeah, we're still registering 248. 2 thou off is not bad. I'm just gonna see how it fits my wood hinge drill jig. Now what's the most important is that this your dowel fit your drill jig. So there it is. And that's actually a nice fit. That's not going to leave any marks. There's no side-to-side slop. So I would say that's great. We could also check and see how it lays in a groove cut by the bit that we're using. So I'll just snap a piece off. And that seems to fit well too. So there you go. Only downside being that I guess I wouldn't use bloodwood because it actually stains any blonde wood. But other than that, we managed to luck out. I thought it was going to take a whole lot longer, but if you enjoy my method of work and like my style of teaching, click on any one of these videos to help take your woodworking to the next level. Now, I've always said better tools make the job so much easier. If you click on the icon with the plane and the chisel, it'll take you to our website, introduce you to all of our tools that we actually manufacture right here, as well as our workshops, both in person and online. Good luck.